ஹரே கிருஷ்ணா. லெசன் 7, ஸ்ரத்தாவான், ஃபெத்ஃபுல். வெல்கம் நோட், வெல்கம் நோட். ஹரே கிருஷ்ணா டியர் டிவோட்டீஸ், ப்ளீஸ் அக்செப்ட் ஆர் ஹார்ட்ஃபுல் வெல்கம். ப்ளீஸ் ஃபாலோ த இன்ஸ்ட்ரக்ஷன்ஸ் ஆஸ் பர் த ப்ரீவியஸ் வீக். தட் மீன்ஸ் வில் பி ஸ்டாண்ட் சிட்டிங் இன் அ சர்க்கிள் அண்ட் டிஸ்கஸிங். கம்மிங் இன் டைம், யா, இட்ஸ் ஆல் ரைட். வி ஹாவ் டு கம் இன் டைம் இன் திஸ் கிளாஸ் பை ஃபோர்ஸ். Introduction or icebreaker, please share some rules which you follow or you have seen parents following when you handle some sacred items like laminations of Lord or spiritual books. So then the devotees can mention what they have seen in their houses, otherwise followed also without Krishna consciousness. These are practical things which are taught. It's very good. Apart from that, whatever is will be taught in this lesson, we'll discuss. So this part, devotees will have to discuss in the group what they have seen in their houses. Now, handling sacred items, we'll read this slowly. Books, beads, kartals, etc. should not be kept on the floor or in unclean places and should be respected as worshipable paraphernalia. People can bypass it by using a Kindle. But still, we should keep our books and all these things clean places. One should not touch one's feet to anything sacred or use one's feet to do what could be done with one's hands. This is very important. Sometimes I saw one devotee pushing the prasadam bucket with his feet, which is very offensive. Should not be done. If a sacred object falls to the ground or one's foot touches, one should quickly pick it up and touch it to one's head. If like something falls down, then like something like sacred, like mobile or whatever, something this is like very sacred, it falls down and you just take it with your hand and pick it up like this, like Bhagavad Gita or anything. One should not step over books, devotees, prasadam, flowers that have been offered to the Lord, or over any sacred articles. Sometimes devotees are standing in your way, they are paying obeisances, so it's not that we can just step over them and then, you know, approach the Lord. This is a great offense. Oh, why this is coming in my, this opposition of anartha coming in my way. I will go over this obstacle. It's understood. All sacred articles should be kept in a neat, clean place and handled with care. They should not be tossed about, but carefully handed over from person to person. Yeah, sometimes it happens that devotees take flowers which are offered to the Lord and throw at other people. It's not proper. Or prasadam also. Sacred items like beads, books, tilak, etc. should not be taken into the bathroom. That's understood. One should be very careful in handling pictures of Guru and Krishna. They should be handled with great care and respect. This is important that we don't take too many photos of our spiritual masters and then just throw them around in the room. One or two, whatever is there, you can keep in your almira like that. But not too many, then not that you are not able to take care of them, and then they are just loitering around, whatever, not loitering, but strewn around in the room. One should be careful while offering obeisances that the bead bag in one's hand does not touch the floor. It may be kept aside before offering obeisances. This is very clear. Nothing to explain this. Mangalacharan, Vaishnav Pranam. We should memorize this. Vanchakalpatarubhyasya kripa sindubhya evacha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. I offer my respectful obeisances unto all the Vaishnav devotees of the Lord. They can fulfill the desires of everyone just like desire trees, and they are full of compassion for the fallen souls. Today is Ekadashi and I was doing Vrindavan Parikrama, which I normally don't do. But while I was doing this, I was deeply thinking about it, that this is not really the process of purification for me. I'm saying something strange. I'm not saying we should not do parikrama of Vrindavan. But we are not normal sadhus. Or not even normal would-be sadhus. I will not say I'm sadhu, but I would be sadhu. We are sadhus under the patronage of Srila Prabhupada, who simply are not interested only in their purification, but in the purification of other souls also. If I go keep on going around Vrindavan doing parikrama, that's fine. every day I can do that, but that will only purify me. There's no doubt about it. But then if I stay in the temple, which as I normally do, I attend Guru Puja, we do Kirtan, you know, very nice Kirtans are there, all the whatever is there. And so many people who come from outside, they will get much more purified by that. Are you able to understand this point? There are so many other sadhus who will just keep on doing it, and we have due respect for them. We are not saying that they are not pure or anything. They can do that. But that's not what Prabhupada has taught us. And Prabhupada also has not told us that we cannot do parikrama. But that cannot be our regular sadhana. Every day we go for parikrama and they do not get association of any devotee when they come to temple. There has to be enthusiastic kirtan happening, there has to be enthusiastic katha happening, whatever. And this way people get association of devotees. You must understand, again a very good reflection which I got today. You see, unless you hear from people who are attached to Krishna, we cannot awaken to the desire to be Krishna conscious. Are you able to understand? No, by no other means. So we have to be as Krishna conscious as possible and also give people a chance to hear about Krishna. Obviously, when we are giving people a chance to hear about Krishna, we are also getting purified. And I give you the example, while I was doing parikrama, there was a person who was selling some kind of oil. There was a company, so when first seller made his announcement, I didn't care. When the second person made an announcement, as I was moving along on the loudspeaker, then I said, maybe it is good. When the third one said, then I said, yeah, I should buy it. Then the fourth one, and I heard, then I said, I should really buy it, but then I said, I don't have money right now. So you understand how by hearing the glorification of some mundane thing, which may not be good, may not be good, we develop a desire to have it. So unless a person hears about Krishna, who is the real vastu, you're not cheating. That if Krishna is God, you're not cheating anybody. And if you explain about his qualities, we don't cheat anybody. So that is real compassion, allowing people to hear about Krishna. And this Bhakti Vriksh book is very nice because it actually allows pervasiveness of Krishna consciousness. The teachers of Krishna consciousness get trained and they can give Krishna Katha at a very local level, very deep, very, very deep, very close level. Are you able to understand? If somebody learns this science through Bhakti Vriksh, he can go very deep into society where people are completely ignorant of the goal of life. And that should be the real mood of a devotee, that he is not simply interested in his own purification, but also in purifying others. And in that process, he himself is more and more purified. So that's how it is there. Okay. Chanting, japa, an exclusive activity. Beautiful. So please read. And I'll stop you as we keep on discussing that. It's very important. Yes.
When we attach importance to some activity, we keep aside some time exclusively for that activity.
Okay, that first line itself is very important. When do we attach importance to some activity? When we hear the value of that activity. As we hear from Srila Prabhupada and all the acharyas, that the name is not different from Krishna. So how much, or my relationship with the holy name is my relationship with Krishna. So how much important it will become to my existence to chant Hare Krishna, or whatever amount I am chanting, to give my full attention in that. I'll go very slowly in this paragraph. This is very important. And Srila Prabhupada explains, by chanting Hare Krishna, we'll realize that the only object of my love is Krishna. As we keep on chanting nicely, that fact becomes more and more enhanced in our consciousness. Only when japa is an exclusive activity for us. We have to hear it, make japa an exclusive activity, no other activity in that. And this fact will be enhanced in our consciousness. My only job is to focus my consciousness on Krishna. Go ahead.
Similarly, a free devotee must spend the time required for chanting his or her prescribed rounds exclusively for japa and for no other activity, even if it's some form of devotional service.
Just like very simple, if you are on the altar, can you eat prasadam simultaneously? On one hand you can have laddu, other hand you can do arati of the Lord. They are both devotional services. So simple example and things make clear by that. So we see this, chant Hare Krishna also, and then, you know, people wave their hands in which they are chanting their mala, shake the mala like this, hey Prabhu come here, like that, and then they talk. So it should become an exclusive activity. Exclusive means I am only chanting. Leave alone the mind, just don't do anything else. That itself is so purifying. So that is very important, and for that, those things are very, which are very destructive to us, should be kept away, just like phones and mobile phones and all those things, and then naturally it will become an exclusive activity. Even if you are doing parikrama, in the sense when I do temple four times parikrama when I'm chanting after 1 hour or so, still we can see down and introspectively try to hear more and more. I always remember this pastime of Arjuna and Dronacharya. Dronacharya was training them for a while, and then he said that, okay, he put a bird on a tree, you know, that tree branch, and then, okay, he called Yudhishthira, what do you see? He said, I see you, I see Kauravas, I see Pandavas. He said, go aside, you cannot hit the target. Then he called everybody else, and everybody almost get the same answer. He said, you can't hit. Then he called Arjuna, he said, what do you see? He said, I only see the bird. Actually, I don't see the bird, I only see the bird's eye, I cannot see anything else. Can you see me? No, nothing I can see. Okay, shoot. And then when he shot, he actually hit the bird's eye. That always, almost always I remember this. Every day we have that opportunity to focus our mind on the holy name like that way. What others are doing, we have no business. What others want to do, we have no business. But we want to be like this. I mean, at least I want to be like that. We are not chanting billions of rounds, 16 rounds. As much as possible, if we can do that. Focused. Yes.
For example, while chanting rounds, one should not be reading newspaper or talking to others, or well, even hearing to kirtans for that matter. Japa is an activity that demands our complete undivided attention.
Yeah, and then we get exclusive results also. If you make it as an exclusive activity, it will give you exclusive results. An extreme purification of heart, intense purification of heart, reflective consciousness, introspective consciousness. Yes.
When we chant the holy name, we are direct communion with the Supreme Lord, Sri Krishna, because Krishna is non-different from His name. In the form of His name, Krishna, the most important personality in all creation, is giving us an audience. Therefore, nothing should be allowed to interrupt this holy meeting.
Like our Sudama Prabhu has sometimes before, he had to go to Indonesia or Malaysia to meet some very important person. So you went all the way from here to Malaysia to meet that very big person or influential person. So when you were meeting him, were you actually checking WhatsApp or reading newspaper? What is your answer? Tell us on the mic.
I will just meet him.
Yes, you are very focused.
Very focused.
Isn't it? Because this influential person can give us so much benefit and rewards. So are we treating the holy name as a person? Or are we treating him only as a vibration? That is a difficulty. We are seeing it only as a vibration. So treating him as a person means giving our attention to him in terms of activity, in terms of mind. So mind is still difficult. At least the activity should be as an exclusive activity. And that's why it should be done in the association of devotees who are in that mood, who are geared for that kind of thing at that time. Like I'm talking particularly for temple devotees. We have fixed time for chanting japa. Apart from that, those who are staying in homes also, they should make it as an exclusive activity by entering into grihastha ashram, in grihastha ashram, after 2 hours. I'll repeat my statement. Suppose your grihastha life starts at, let's say, 6 o'clock. So you wake up at 4 o'clock. So from 4 to 6, you're not in the grihastha ashram. You're dead. You're dead for the grihastha ashram because you became alive for grihastha ashram after 6 o'clock. I'll repeat this. When we sleep, we are dead. When we are sleeping, we are dead for practical purposes. We can't do anything for anybody. If you are sleeping, you ask, Sir, Mishraji, in which ashram you are? We are dead, isn't it? So we are dead. So let us become dead. Anyhow, we are dead from 4 to 6. Yes? So now 6 o'clock when a person wakes up and then attends to his grihastha duties, so before that you remain awake for 2 hours or whatever time it takes. Yes. And then after a while so you become awake for 6 o'clock. But unless I make it as a priority, I won't do it. That is the point. So this is very important. I know so many devotees, at least few devotees who chant, who will wake up at 2 o'clock to chant their rounds. Grihastha devotees. 2 to 4 they will chant and then they will attend to their grihastha business or whatever. Yes, sir.
One lecture I was hearing that Maharaj was telling that devotee approached Prabhupada. And she was like very much into all this temple program, but when she got married, so she was like very much feeling separation from whole schedule and she was not able to complete the rounds. So when she approached Prabhupada, so Prabhupada said that this all the activities like you chanting, your prescribed rounds and your Bhagavatam reading and all, you should complete by 10 o'clock. Any which ways. Anyhow, you have to complete by 10 o'clock.
Yeah, anything. Sudama Prabhu gave me a good advice. Anything you want to do regularly, you keep it in your morning schedule. Somehow there every day you will notice doing something in the morning is very pleasurable. Whatever you do, whether you read, whether you hear, have you noticed that? Whether you hear, you chant japa, even if you clean your room or you wash your clothes or you do shaving, everything is pleasurable in morning hours. So that should give us indication if I want to chant good japa, best time is morning hours. Everything is nice to do in the morning hours. Okay. Topic of discussion, Sanatana Dharma. This is a very big chapter and we will go slowly. Today probably we will discuss one paragraph and then we'll go ahead slowly. We'll see how much time we have. Very interesting. Eternal Father of Eternal Living Entities. Yes.
In this material world, we find that everything is temporary. It comes into being, stay for some time, produce some byproducts, will lust and then vanishes. That is the
one thing I'm just thinking, our anarthas are also temporary. They are not eternal. Anartho upashamo sakshat bhaktim yogam bhakti yogam adhokshaje lokasya janato vidvams chakre satvata sahitam. These anarthas are superfluous to the living entity. It is not touching the living entity. So if you continue the process of bhakti, they will also go away. But anyhow, this is some different context. Yes. So it is mentioned here that our bodies, anything in this material world has this 6 transformation. It arises, it maintains for some time and grows, gives some byproducts and finishes. So what did we learn from this? This is very slow, I'll go. It's a very nice chapter. What did we learn?
We learn in the case of devotional service, it's also in case of our anarthas, it may be grow, but if we actually following the process, it actually gradually
it also dies. It will clear off. But what I wanted to say is, like a bubble, things are coming and going off, like this. How much value do I attach to a bubble? Sometimes if you see where the fishes are stayed, aquarium, they have some machine which produces bubbles Do you count how many bubbles are there? Have you ever counted? Do you care how many bubbles are there? That's what. Actually, we should not become attached to the things of this world because they are just like bubbles. Even our bodies also. Even our achievements also. Bubbles in time. Finished. Even the whole universe is like a bubble in time eternity. Sometimes just for a moment you just try to go and think about time eternity. And then it's shocking. All our problems are bubbles. Finished. So real problem is Sapne yathahi pratibhog dhagate Hari smriti sarva vipad vimokshanat. Beautiful shloka. Just like all the problems are solved when you wake up. All the problems of dream are solved when you wake up. Similarly, Hari smriti sarva vipad vimokshanat. If we evolve to our relationship with Krishna, we get remembrance of Krishna, all our problems are solved. That is the law of the material world. Go ahead.
Whether we use as example this body or a piece of fruit or anything, but beyond this temporary world, there is another world which is we have information. That world consists of another nature which is Sanatan, eternal.
I will say a very interesting point. A person is considered to be very intelligent by Shastra, who by offering temporary things of this world to Krishna attains eternal reality. Have you understood? I'll again say this. Lord Krishna says patram pushpam. No, he says that yad karoshi yad ashnasi yad juhosi dadasi yad yad tapasyasi kauntiya tad karush padarpanam. Whatever you do, whatever you eat, whatever activities you perform, you do it as an offering to me, and by which you will come to me. Shubha shubha for like that. So now whatever we do here is temporary because we are doing with temporary body. But if you offer that to Krishna, which anyhow it belongs to him, but anyhow if you offer to Krishna, then Krishna says you will reach the eternal reality, eternal spiritual world. So are you not intelligent in that way? You have a fruit which anyhow is going to get decomposed. So you offer to Krishna and take prasadam and go back to God. Now makes sense? So intelligent person is that. Yes.
Jiva is also described as Sanatan, eternal, and the Lord is also described as Sanatan. We have an intimate relationship with the Lord, and because we are all qualitatively one, the Sanatan Dharma or sky, the Sanatan Supreme Personality and the Sanatan Living Entities. The whole purpose of Bhagavad Gita is to revive our Sanatan occupation or Sanatan Dharma, which is the eternal occupation of the living entity. We are temporarily engaged in different activities, but all of these activities can be purified when we give up all these temporary activities and take up the activities which are prescribed by the Supreme Lord. That is called our pure life.
I will explain this point because it talks about Bhagavad Dharma also. Dharma also means duties. So like Stri Dharma means duties of a woman. Raj Dharma means duties of a king. Then Vipra Dharma will be called duties of a Brahmana. So these are circumstantial nemitic dharmas. One living entity will be a woman for certain period of time. So Stri Dharma is called Naimittika Dharma, is called circumstantial. Her circumstance is now is to be a woman, so she will have to be following the duties of a woman. Is it clear? I will be a Brahmana for this lifetime. So these are my duties. A king will be having, will be a king for certain amount of time. This is his dharma. Is it clear? It's called Naimittik Dharma. But Sanatan Dharma, Nitya Dharma means the activities or the duties which I have towards God. I'll repeat this point. Bhagavad Dharma, Nitya Dharma, Sanatan Dharma, all three are the same things, means activities or duties which are towards God and they are eternal. And our eternal nature is to be a servant of God. So evolving to our pure life means evolving to our true nature of being a servant of God. Actually, we should not try, very nice thing which a devotee told me, don't try to be a brahmachari, don't try to be a grihastha or vanaprastha or sannyasi, just try to be a servant. I beautifully like this point, because this is our natural position. As soon as you get too much involved with brahmachari, grihastha, vanaprastha, naturally there is always a chance that I become proud. When I was finishing my parikrama today, one Indian person called me, Maharaj, Babaji, what, are you a Brahmin? I said, no. Oh, I am a Brahmin. Very good. Hare Krishna. Are you understand the point? He was not even wearing a dhoti kurta, but he was getting pride in being a Brahmin. He doesn't know anything about the science of soul. Brahma janati iti brahmana. Nothing. He doesn't know. If you would have asked him, what is the meaning of brahmana? He doesn't know. But when I say I am not a brahmana, then I am also saying I am also not a shudra. I am also not a kshatriya. I am nothing. I am simply trying to be a servant of the servant of the Lord. Beautiful point. And it very easily makes you free from false ego. If you just practice that, I'm not saying that I'm completely accomplished in it, but if you practice that, I'm just a servant, which is my real situation. Very nice. That is our pure life, being a servant of the Supreme Lord. Yes.
The Supreme Lord and His transcendental abode are both sanatan.
You have to keep the mic close that you hear in the speaker, so that, and then only it will go into the phone. Yeah.
As are the living entities, and the combined association of the Supreme Lord and the living entities in the sanatan abode is the perfection of human life. The Lord is very kind to the living entities because they are His sons. Lord Krishna declares in Bhagavad Gita, Sarva Yonisu, Aham Bija Pradapita. I am the father of all. Of course, there are all types of living entities according to their various karmas. But here the Lord claims that He is the father of all of them. Therefore, the Lord descends to reclaim all of these fallen souls.
Fallen conditioned
souls. Fallen conditioned souls. To call them back to the sanatan eternal sky so that the sanatan living entities may regain their eternal sanatan position in eternal association with the Lord. The Lord comes Himself in different incarnation, or He sends His confidential servant as His son, or His associate or acharyas to reclaim the conditioned souls.
So you see how Srila Prabhupada's mood is very much very clear from Vanchakalpataru, as I was, I opened the discussion with that. The confidential servant of the Lord is not simply thinking about his own purification. He understands what will be pleasing to the Lord. Just like you see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was thinking, how the Muslims will be delivered. They are eating cow. Then Maharidas Thakur say, they chant haram haram and they will be delivered by that. Oh, then how the trees will be delivered. Or devotees chant Hare Krishna very loudly, in this way they will be delivered. So you see, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the Supreme Lord, is not simply thinking about Hindus. He's not simply thinking about Brahmins. He's thinking about everybody. Because he's not relating to them as Brahmana, Kshatriya, Shudra or anything. He's seeing them as souls covered in different encasements, different bodies, so to speak, and with different levels of ignorance. So he's like a father who has one child a little less evolved, I would say, mentally challenged also. Some children are mentally challenged. So that, does it mean that the father is hating that child? He also wants that child to flourish. Prabhupada has said that also, I think, in which chapter he has said, in the coming chapters it will be discussed. If the child is mentally challenged, then the elder brother say, Father, let us kill him and eat him. The father say, no, I am maintaining. You are not maintaining. He is my son. Why you worry? So similarly, the Lord, when He comes, when He says, Sarva Dharman Parityaja, He is for everybody, all living entities. at least those who have full some consciousness, at least for human beings. But actually, by the process of chanting Hare Krishna, everybody can be delivered, practically speaking. Even the flies, they're not here, they can be delivered. So many people who chant in the mind, so they might deem, first of all, this is very questionable with what they're chanting. So we don't know how much they're getting benefit. But suppose if they're chanting Hare Krishna, only they are getting the benefit. But somebody who chants it loud, then everybody else can hear and he will get benefit. Okay, so question is, what is the purpose of Bhagavad Gita? Very clear. To bring the conditioned souls back to Godhead in the eternal atmosphere. Very clear. And no other purpose of Bhagavad Gita. Very clear. What is the purpose of pizza? It's very clear. It's very clear. What is the purpose of curd? Very clear. Curd is not to make an explosion. What is the purpose of a chocolate? It's extremely clear. Don't have to give any other explanation, no interpretation. Isn't it? So similarly, Bhagavad Gita's only purpose is to bring the living entities, forgetful souls, back to Godhead. Question number 2. What all things are eternal? The living entity, the Lord and Lord's supreme abode, eternal abode. Question number 3, sorry, question number 2 I should have said. Okay, question number 3 now. Everybody is happy in his spiritual world. So what is the need of Lord and his confidential servitors to come in this material world? That's a good question. What is the answer need? Speak a little slowly and clearly.
Like Krishna tells in Bhagavad Gita, yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata. So as we know, like, Lord comes for basically two reasons. First reason is that paritrana sadhunam, in order to basically deliver the sadhus and vinashayat dushkritam, those who are like miscreants, in order to...
Your answer is correct, but in context to what we have discussed, very simple answer is very clear. To reclaim the conditioned souls, because they also belong to him. Very simple. Your answer is not wrong, but in this context it's very simple. The Lord and his servants, they also love the other souls. And the servants know that the Father, Supreme Lord, will be happy if they bring other souls back on the path back to Godhead. Even if the souls can't come immediately back to Godhead, even if they're just brought on track of going back to Godhead, that itself is a great service. Because this track is only one way. Have you understood this point? If you somehow help a person to chant Hare Krishna, he may not immediately go back to Godhead. But now his material life has practically stopped. Now he has been put on track of going back to Godhead. Moksha gamanam prati. Even once somebody chants Hari, his material life has stopped. Now he has... tightened his seat belt, so to say, to go back to Godhead. It's mentioned in sixth canto, second chapter. I'm forgetting the shloka, but it's mentioned that in the purport. Acharyas give this quotation. So this is very important, and that is the sign of a real devotee who understands what will please the Supreme Lord the best. So he will devise various ways by which he can at least bring the conditioned souls back on track. So that can be our homework for whole night or for whole day or for whole life. How can I somehow bring a soul at least on track back to Godhead? I would like to go a little slowly on this. I'll stop here and we'll discuss it further.